Evening and welcome. As you are no doubt aware, the nation is at present awash in champagne and gay with buntings in celebration of 50 years of broadcasting. Bonfires glow from every hilltop. People dance in the streets. Well, that's the background and the setting to tonight's extra special edition of my show. Looking back over 50 years of broadcasting, wading through the BBC archives, we picked out several people from the past and invited them to participate in tonight's show. Now, these are the beloved names of broadcasting, the people whose voices became as familiar to millions of people as their own front door. Anyway, without more ado, let me name just a few of the voices you'll hear tonight. They are, in order of size, Henry Crung, Minnie Bannister, Colonel Bloodnok, Eccles, Neddy Seagoon, and many more. Brought to you by those three anonymous gentlemen who for years have so selflessly sacrificed their real selves in the cause of art. Tonight I can reveal they are Peter Sellers, Spike Milligan, and Harry Secombe. I shall make the introductions in order of waist measurements. Ladies and gentlemen, Harry Secombe.
Hello!
Harry, when can you remember when you first made people laugh?
I suppose it was in a church social, you know. Because when I was a lad, most of the social activity was centered around the church. Yeah. And I was a sort of the community idiot. Yeah, I used to make myself laugh and everybody else.
And they used to invite you along to make people laugh, did you?
Yes, well, we had church socials and sort of outings, and I was always the one who did impressions of the vicar.
Yeah.
Vicar didn't like it. Yeah.
Have you always found that wherever you go, whichever situation you're in, that you make people laugh? I mean, for instance, you were in the army, weren't you?
Yes, on your side.
On our side.
Yes.
But was that a kind of rich area for...
It was a great place for... Because there's so many things happen in the army, so many things go wrong, you know. And I remember once being marched off parade in Aldershot. There's a bloke in front of me. We're on being inspected by the GOAC. GOAC? GOC. GOAC, the GOC. GOC of Southern Command. We're all lined up in open ranks, you see, for inspection. And this fellow was standing at ease. And he had a very thin neck, and his battle dress, his overcoat, was like that, you know, with a big gap there. And he had his fore and aft, his forage cap, right on like that. And there was a big dent in there. And it was pouring with rain, and this thing was filling up with water. And I could see it all happening behind him, and I'm going, trying not to laugh. So when they said, "Tension," he came to attention, he went, "Oh, look what it done." And I went, "Ah!" I was marched off the parade ground.
Were you constantly in trouble in the army? Or?
Well, yes. I remember once we were on guard duty, and they'd taken our... 1940 was... Before your time, I remember. 1940. And they made me... I was a lance bombardier. It was a mistake, but I was a lance bombardier. And they made me sort of marching... In charge of marching reliefs outside a tent. We were in a tent, but I was outside. They wouldn't let me inside. And there was a lake in front of us, and there was this tent. And they'd taken our rifles away, the Lee Enfield rifles, and given us Ross rifles, Canadian Ross rifles, which had no cutout. Which means you put the magazine in with a Ross, with an Enfield. Are you still with us? You put the magazine in the rifle, and with a Lee Enfield, you could put a cutout there. So when you put the bolt and fired the trigger, nothing went up the spout. So, bearing this in mind, Jim, they give us this. We only had one magazine between the lot of us, so that I had to take the rifle off the fella who was. Coming off guard, the next one on guard, and I ceremoniously put the magazine in, put the bolt forward, pulled the trigger, and blew a hole through the tent. And it missed a fellow by about that much. We ran into the lake and broke a toe on the Molotov cocktail. I was in a charge.
I think you made that up, just
no, now. But word of honour, right? Yes. Bellamore Park outside Rugeley. Mm. Ask the lads, they're right in.
Because you had something happen to you in the army, apart from shooting people. You met Spike Milligan, didn't you?
I did. Oh, that was... that's a long story. I'll make it very quick.
Yes.
Yes. Take your time. Anyway. It was all... Hello, Mike. We're in position in North Africa, up on a plateau near the Shawash Valley. I've got a memory for names, you know. I don't know where it was, but it was called the Shawash Valley. and there was this plateau thing, and we couldn't get the Germans out of these hills. We kept sending them letters, but they wouldn't go, you know. Come out, and they wouldn't. So they sent for these big guns. I was 25 pounder regiment, by the way, artillery. You know, the 5 mile snipers, they called us. I had to lead retreats, you know. I was wearing my uniform back to front. Well, I was advancing, but I was making for the Maffey. We had these gun pits they dug, you see. Our gun pits weren't big enough for this big 7.2 gun howitzer they sent up from Algiers to get the Germans out, you know, make a big visiting card. So they came in at what they call a night occupation, and they went in the gun pit we dug for them, and they went in on the top of this plateau. And I was in a command post at the bottom of a 150-foot cliff here. So anyway, they fired this first round with this big gun at night, and the sergeant said, "Fire, pull the lanyard." And when he turned on, the gun had gone. This huge gun had jumped out of the gun pit, and it came clattering over where we were and missed us by a few yards, you know, in this little truck. And I thought, they're throwing guns at us. So nobody knew what had happened, you see. So the next thing we knew, the back of the truck parted, the canopy, and a face came through. Anybody seen a gun? And it was Milligan, because he was on the crew of the gun, and he says he's still paying for it.
Was this the start of the Goons then, Harry?
Well, I met him later in Italy, where we were on a thing called Settled Pool of Artists outside Naples, and I met him there, and we had this marvellous reunion. You know, there's this terrible sense of humour that nobody else really understood. Yeah. And we did a show called Over the Page. Terrible it was, but we used to get hysterical. And when I came out of the army, I went to the Wimble Theatre, where I met Mike Benteen. He was half of an act called Sherwood and Forrest. Sherwood and Forrest.
That one out.
He was actually Forrest, because there was a bloke called Michael Sherwood who played the piano, or Tony Sherwood played the piano. And I introduced Spike to Mike, and then later we met Peter, and that's how it all started.
Hmm. You were saying that not many people understood his kind of humour, that kind of zany humour. And in fact, I remember when the Goons started, that people were reading all kinds of intellectual things into your humour, weren't they?
Oh, yes.
Shades
Kafka,
of Inesco.
Yes, Dylan Thomas, yeah. But
what was it to you, though, at that time? I mean, you know, what did you think you were creating?
Well, we were, first of all, against most of the established kind of humour that was existing at the time, you know, the hat turn up in the front, and the I say, if anything happened to me, or the routine of gags thing, and probably because we couldn't tell jokes very well, I could never remember the endings. So I did a shaving routine, the way different people shave, but that was my act.
This is when you were on the halls?
Yes, round the halls.
Yeah, yeah.
And I got taken off the bill at Bolton.
Why?
The manager came up to me and said, "You're not shaving my bloody time," he said. And I was paying off for the Monday night first house. So I sent a telegram to Mike Benteen. "Audience with me all the way, managed to shake him off at the station."
What was it like, Harry, that period on the halls when you were doing a solo spot?
Well, it's a bit frightening, you know, because you're there and the dancing girls go on, a bit of a routine. Then you're on, and it's all the old teeth caught. "Hello, folks!" all the eye flickering. Especially Monday night first house in the winter, when you play Blackpool in the winter, you know, there's nobody out there except the landladies or something.
Yeah.
And they're all on the Wilkie Bar. They're all coming for nothing. Yeah. And to get them going, you've got to stay there for 8 minutes to get them going before the next act comes on.
Yeah.
And I once came on with a shaving act at Huddersfield, I think. I put my little table down with all the thing on it, and started, "Everybody has to shave," and I said, the table moved away at the rake of the stage like that, and everything fell on top of the orchestra. I didn't know what to do, you know, nothing left, that was my act. So I went, and ad-libbed.
But I was talking to Peter earlier, and he was saying that one thing about you was that whereas if the others died on stage, as they did occasionally, you could always burst into song.
Yes, I was always lucky there.
Yeah.
Get the old truss on and go, the tenor's friend. Yes.
Well, a trusted tenor's friend. Yes. Great description.
Yes, just the baritone's buddy.
But when did you, I mean, did you ever consider a serious career in singing at all?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.